have five experts in five areas. I will present them briefly, and then I will ask them, please, to each of them. Maybe we start by you, Nicole, and then we'll go to my right.
Yeah, good morning, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much to the organizer. I'm going to talk about energy. So challenges are many, climate change, energy security, energy access. And today what I'm going to focus is on these last issues. We have 1.3 billion people without access to improve energy services, which is the role of technology on this. And as we might think, clearly a microgrid is technology-based. But if you are a little bit familiar with what with the ongoing discussion now in the rural electrification arena, you will have observed that technology is absent. That the only thing everybody is talking about is public-private partnership and leveraging private funds. So the main challenge on technology innovation in this sector is that nobody is focusing on technology. They are only focusing on euro, dollars, or whatever you might want. Which are the opportunities? The opportunities that, unfortunately, the market is very big. 1.3 billion people is a very huge market. What we take as an opportunity for technology innovation in this sector is the network. There is a huge network of people working on this, and together with people with, we prefer bottom-up approach instead of supply approach as we were discussing yesterday with Hans. So challenges is that we are not in the agenda, opportunities that we are many people with a lot of experience in this field. And I will stop here.
Thank you. I also want to start by thanking INSEAD and the organizers for asking me to speak here today. Just a brief note, I represent the United Nations Millennium Campaign. It is a campaign which is part of UNDP, the United Nations Development Programme, and we work towards the attainment of a global roadmap which was agreed to combat poverty, which are the Millennium Development Goals. Really, in the last few years, one of the things that have happened is that technology has really become a game changer in the public sphere. So what I mean by this is that it has strengthened or at least initiated greater accountability. It has improved or it is beginning to improve service delivery. And also, in some ways, we are beginning to see that technology is enabling crowdsourcing of public policy. What people say all over the world is the number one driver for improving lives is education. So no matter whether you're asking this question in Egypt, or you're asking it in Tanzania, or you are asking it in China, or you're asking it in the States, everybody answers in the same way. It is education which improves my life. And then, depending on certain regions of the world, number two, number three will be health. And then number two, number three is an open and responsive government. So I leave it there.
Thank you. Anand?
Thank you, Jose. Jose has given me 5 minutes time to talk about multiple things. So I'd like to divide this 5 minutes into probably four sections. First is to just to give you a context about healthcare and healthcare in India. Then briefly talk about LifeSpring Hospital. The third part would be what made LifeSpring different, the reason why I've been invited here. And the final would be around the challenges that we face in our district. If you look at the choices that women have in India today, before LifeSpring came, was two impossible choices in a way, if you ask me. One side, they had this government hospitals, which are, you know, if they are functioning, they are overcrowded, under-resourced, and more and biggest, there's no privacy and dignity and respect that they would have in that hospital. The other choice they have is these big private corporate hospitals, which are world-class but very expensive, out of reach of most of the people. And this is where LifeSpring came in, which I founded, is basically trying to provide high quality care at a price that the working poor can afford. The challenges that we face, and here I would talk about technology challenges, although as a social enterprise there are many other challenges that we face. The technology challenge that we faced was, one was to do the investment. If you want to bring technology in healthcare, especially hospital setting, it requires a huge investment. The second challenge that we faced was around reliability. Clinically, you need data, you need information, patient's data. The third challenge was around behavior, you know, changing the behavior or the relationship between the doctors and patients. So these are the three challenges that I would like to stop at, and definitely happy to take questions.
Buenos días. Soy una emprendedora social y creo que llegué a esto porque en mis épocas de investigación y de academia, soy geógrafa, vengo de Argentina, empecé a percibir una realidad que no me gustaba. Creo que todos estamos en un mundo donde percibimos que hay cosas que no nos conforman y creo que es nuestra obligación reflexionar y ver cómo podemos implementar soluciones que cambien esta realidad. Empecé hace 13 años esta organización que se llama Responde, que tiene puesta la mirada sobre los desequilibrios territoriales y sobre la búsqueda de cómo encontrar soluciones para que la gente pueda crecer junto a sus raíces sin necesidad de emigrar. En los 10 primeros años empezamos a aprender qué había en los pueblos, qué capacidades, qué oportunidades, qué recursos, cómo podíamos lograr que ellos se desarrollaran sin tanta inversión. Éramos una ONG, no éramos gobierno, no éramos empresa. En todos estos pueblos, por supuesto que en la mayor parte hay dificultades de acceso a la tecnología, acceso a Internet, y no solamente Internet, muchas veces a las comunicaciones. Pueden tener todos muchos teléfonos, pero hay muchos pueblos donde la gente tiene que subirse a algún lugar en especial y empieza así para ver dónde hay señal. De verdad, esto es difícil. Así que, bueno, desde mi lugar les quería contar que nosotros creemos que la tecnología es clave para el desarrollo de los pueblos y de la resolución de tantas necesidades que tienen, desde salud a través de la telemedicina. Creemos que tenemos una oportunidad, sabemos que estamos en un camino difícil de transitar porque son cosas que son mucho más fáciles cuando los gobiernos apoyan, pero de todas maneras tenemos una apuesta grande y esto es lo que quería compartir con ustedes. Gracias.
Gracias, Marcela.
Quiero empezar por las oportunidades porque me parece que tenemos que intentar poner las cosas en positivo y luego tratar de ver cómo resolvemos los problemas y no hacerlo al revés. Creo que tendríamos que empezar en la educación a los 5 años, cuando yo pienso que hay que empezar con todo el tema del emprendimiento y la innovación. Había que empezar a usar adecuadamente estas herramientas, el internet seguro, el correo electrónico, las redes sociales, el crowdfunding, los blogs, las tablets, todo esto son unas herramientas maravillosas que creo que se deberían utilizar muy pronto. Necesitamos todos los países, mejorar la educación. ¿Y eso cómo se hace? Bueno, pues por supuesto que las nuevas tecnologías tienen que ayudar, pero yo no creo que la solución sea poner en cada aula un ordenador por cada alumno. Los jóvenes y los niños están utilizando las nuevas tecnologías que a ellos les interesan, que no son las que nos interesa a los mayores que dominen. Ellos fundamentalmente pues utilizan las redes sociales, la comunicación, los juegos y poco más. El emprendimiento, la educación y la innovación son una misma cosa, aunque se presentan como cosas distintas, pero, por ejemplo, si no hay emprendedores que lleven una innovación a la sociedad y la conviertan en una innovación de verdad, no se hace. Bueno, yo creo que lo dejo ahí y luego seguiremos hablando de lo que sea necesario. Gracias.